Well, I think it's time for us to go now, Mr. Trimble.
Yeah, well, we better say goodbye, but I'll see you again soon, eh? Yeah. Bye for
bye.
Now.
Bye.
Bye-bye.
Here on, Mr. Trimble.
Yeah, here we are. Let's make it. Yes, here on.
Now it's time for this year's Faraday Lecture, The Entertaining Electron. Dr. Boris Townsend and Howard Steele from the Independent Broadcasting Authority explain some of the technical mysteries behind this magical box of tricks, the television.
Chicago, Chicago.
That toddling town.
Toddling town.
Chicago, Chicago. Show you around.
We love it.
That disaster happened right here in Chicago itself. The pictures, which won an Emmy Award, were beamed direct back to the CBS newsroom by Minicam. Minicam, that's a new method of electronic news gathering, or ENG for short. Three letters that you're going to hear very much more about. No film, just a very small, very sensitive, and portable television camera. I want another CBS Minicam assignment right now. So stay with us, for this program is all about television itself.
On ACR3, standby camera one.
Right, standby. Standby one with your super, standby sound with your quarter-inch tape. Right, coming up immediately after the shot, background sound.
It is, of course, a tremendous...
Howard Steele is the Director of Engineering for the Independent Broadcasting Authority.
I hope that you'll have enjoyed reading in this year's lecture...
On ACR4.
Standby two, ready super, ready quarter-inch tape again. Background sound.
Dr. Boris Townsend is the head of the IBA's Engineering Information Service.
On ACR5 for 3.5 minutes.
Good, that was a very nice sequence, yes. Now we're on this sequence until we mix to ACR6 for Boris Townsend's piece.
Now, ladies and gentlemen, good afternoon. Well now, a couple of years ago, I was browsing through an advertisement board outside a newsagent's in Soho. Those little cards, you know. And as a matter of fact, I'd just drawn my unemployment benefit, and I was wondering what to squander it on. And I was torn, but... Wait a minute. Peter, are you... Exactly... Excuse me. Now, what happens there? Are we mixing there?
No,
or
that'll
do
be
I
a
cut?
Cut. That'll be a cut.
As a cut?
Yes.
You sure? Okay,
yes,
fine.
Yes. Do you have it to go
fine. On? Yeah, fine. Thank
okay.
you. Cut. There we go. Yeah. Don't worry. It'll be perfect on the night. It'll be absolutely fine. Okay. So...
The one and only Frankie Howard in rehearsal for a series called The Howard Confessions. That's how the scene was meant to go, but in fact, this is how it actually went.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Good afternoon. Now, ladies and gentlemen, now, a couple of years ago, I was standing outside a newsagent's shop, you see, and I was browsing through those advertisements you see on the boards, out the little cards outside, you see, browsing through, and as a matter of fact, I'd just drawn my unemployment benefit, and I was wondering, listen, listen, I just, you've put me off now, you see. It's a lot to learn all this, you know. Now, listen, I had just drawn my unemployment laughing myself, and I'm an idiot, but anyway.
Sometimes it's even better on the night. Meanwhile, back to the rehearsal. Produced by Thames Television, this show is a typical example of the sort of work that can be produced in a modern television studio. Now, during every production, there are all sorts of people involved on the studio floor: scene hands, cameramen, makeup artists, designers, floor managers, and many others. And they're all important, and they all have a distinct part to play in any production. But in this year's Faraday lecture, which was all about television today and tomorrow, we were looking especially closely at the role of electrical engineers and technicians in all facets of television. So, without, I hope, interfering too much with Mr. Howard and allowing everyone to get on with their rehearsals, let's first look around at some of the electronics and the equipment and the people involved in making and transmitting television programmes. At any one time, there will be four or five television cameras like this on the studio floor. Each camera is fitted with a zoom lens, which the cameraman can adjust with his left thumb, going wider shot or right into a close-up. The cameras themselves, as you can see, are mounted on a pedestal which floats on nitrogen, so they can be adjusted for height or tracked forwards or backwards. Or they may be mounted on a crane, which gives them extra height and movement. Or perhaps on a special low-angle dolly like this, which can crab along the studio floor and take low-angle shots which are impossible by any other means. Now, I must emphasize that these cameras are all electronic cameras. Look, they're not like film cameras at all. So let's see how they work.
Now, you may think when you're watching television, as now, that you're watching moving pictures, but you're not. As in the old What the Butler Saw machines, you're watching a succession of still pictures, one after the other, 25 times a second, and the persistence of vision merges the still pictures into flowing movement. But we cannot transmit even a still picture. We can only transmit a varying radio signal. This light-sensitive photoelectric cell produces an electric current when light falls upon it. If I scan it along these squares, you'll notice that the current increases as the brightness of the squares increases. But unfortunately, the cell is colorblind. And along these equally bright colored squares, it produces the same reading. But if I change the photocell for a similar cell with red celluloid over it, you'll see that the current is now analogous to the amount of red in each coloured area. Now, for colour television, we need to measure three signals through red, green and blue filters. Each is derived from scanning an image in a series of horizontal lines. Baird's mechanical system effectively scanned by rotating this disc of lenses, so producing 30 vertical lines. And his images would have looked rather worse than these reconstructed pictures. Now, the modern all-electronic system of scanning developed by Sir Isaac Schoenberg and his team is rather faster. On this monochrome stripped-down camera, the lens here produces an image onto the front face of this photoelectric pickup tube, which is the modern equivalent of our moving photocell. And it dissects the image into 625 lines horizontally. Scanning works like this. Let us show you an F for Faraday, who discovered the basic laws of electricity. Now, my magic television screen here is being scanned by 625 lines, but only some 20 of them are crossing over the F itself. So I'm going to press a button on my magic box here, which will magnify up the letter F. Now, you'll notice the lines of which it's made up, and again with my magic box, I can control the rate at which we do this. I'm making the spot come down slowly from the top left-hand corner of your picture. It's off your screen at the moment, but you'll see it in just a second. And here it comes, scanning across the dark parts of the picture. Now it's striking the top of the letter F. Progressing slowly, I'm speeding it up as it gets down towards the bottom of the picture for this demonstration. Now, that's only half the F, actually, and the spot's going to go back to the top of the screen and fill in the missing lines. This is a process which we call interlacing. Now, the spot's coming the second time, it's filling in the missing lines and forming a more complete letter F for us. And the whole process over the whole screen takes 1/25th of a second. Let's look at the signal waveform which our scanning spot is generated. I'll magnify up the F, and at the bottom of the picture, you'll see the voltage waveform. Now, this yellow line strobe marker is brightening up the line whose waveform is being shown at the bottom of the picture. Here it's on a dark part of the picture, the voltage waveform is low. Now I'm crossing the top of the F and the voltage waveform shoots up, corresponding to the width of the F. Now we're on the narrow part of the F. Of course, we see nothing between the scanning lines. Now we're on the broad part of the F again, narrow part, and off the bottom of the picture. Let's do that on a more complicated picture. This is the IBA Engineering Centre at Crawley Court. And you'll notice that as I move the strobe marker up and down, so the voltage waveform increases wherever the scanning spot crosses a white part of the picture. All this varying information, 625 lines each picture, 25 pictures every second, is superimposed on a radio wave carrier and transmitted to your domestic aerial. Your receiver amplifies this signal and uses it to vary the brightness of the spot of light, tracing out similar scanning lines on your screen. Special pulses added to the signal at the studio ensure that the scanning on your screen keeps in step with the scanning in our camera pickup tubes.
Well, that in outline is how it all works. Now let's look a little more closely at how television programs are made.
Camera one.
Up in the production control room, the director has the output of all cameras displayed on separate picture monitors. This is the production control room of Thames Television Studio One at Teddington in London. This is where this part of our programme is being made. In fact, we're using this control room and its cameras to look at a rehearsal of the Frankie Howard show, which is taking place on the studio floor below. Throughout the course of the programme, our director will cut between cameras, either to a pre-arranged script or as the different shots develop and become apparent. At the same time, he can talk to his cameraman, who listen on headphones.
Camera 5, you're going to pan right to an MLS of the French maid.
Sitting by him is his assistant, who is calling shots. She is reminding everyone what number shot this is and which camera the next shot will be on.
8/5 next.
And cut.
On the other side of the director is the vision mixer, who changes the picture source either by cutting between cameras like this and this, or maybe mixing like this and this, or even wiping in a variety of ways. Next to the vision mixer is the technical operations supervisor, whose job it is to look after the whole of the technical side of the studio.
Fine. Ready, everybody? Right, quiet, please. Here we go. Here's the clock. We're off. And VDR 5, we're coming to you in about 5 minutes' time, and I'll roll back and mix. So if you'll take maybe the first two or three cuts so we can get a good rollback on that. John, camera 5 is being slaved for the whole of this opening passage, but after that, we'll go back to it on a normal VDR. Right, there we go.
Can you hold it just a minute, please?
One of the most important contributions to this scene, or indeed any scene, comes from the lighting. A television studio has a very complex lighting system, and it's both technically and artistically the responsibility of one man. He's called the lighting director. He works from a lighting plot that he has drawn up showing which lights he's going to use and in which direction they'll be pointing. The lamps themselves are mounted on individual monopoles, which can be positioned anywhere in the studio from an overhead lighting grid 35 feet above the studio floor. They can be adjusted for direction and have what are called barn doors to keep the lights away from unwanted areas.
I think you need to do.
Here he's rechecking the intensity again on a light meter.
Now, Rob, could you spot it just a little bit more, Rob? Yeah. Whoa. Right, now, can you open the top door just a whisker? Whoa, otherwise we'll get a flare. Okay. Yes, I think that's fine. Okay, super. Yep, we'll buy that. Thank you.
Once the lights have been set in the correct direction, they have to be adjusted for intensity. This again is where a combination of technical skill and artistic flair are needed. The lighting director works off a set of television monitors, not unlike the television sets you've got at home. He can achieve all sorts of effects with his lights, and once he's satisfied with the way they're adjusted, he can record all of the settings on memory circuits on the lighting console.
Now, Brian, if you could flash 167 for us, please. Switch it on and off. See what it's doing. OK, fine, we'll buy that. We need that. Now, the other one I think you want to try is 44. You have to flash if you need it. Right, OK, fine. I think we'll use it, but take it down. Take the top off it a bit, can you? Just pull it down, pull it down. Whoa, fine. OK, if you file it there.
Later, all he has to do is to press a button, and the lights will change to exactly how they were when he last adjusted them. At the same time, the vision control operator, we call him Rax, is electronically adjusting the exposure and colour balance of the cameras. Sound from the studio floor can come from a variety of sources. Sometimes we use a miniature radio microphone like this, but this is the usual method, a microphone on a boom which can be positioned exactly. Now, the position of these microphones is very important. If we turn it away and then pull it, you'll hardly be able to hear what I'm saying. But as it's adjusted back to its correct position, you'll be able to hear me properly again. Now, you'll probably never see a microphone unless someone has made a mistake, but it's always there, just out of shot. Upstairs, in addition to the vision control suite and the production control room, we have the sound control suite. The sound supervisor at any one time could be balancing the output of dozens of live microphones that his team has carefully positioned around the studio, matching sound picture, or adding artificial echo if the production needs it, or making me sound as if I was talking on the telephone, or even over the public address system at a mainline railway station. Also in the control suite, the grams operator can spin in spot effects of any particular sound needed by the production, which can't be made on the studio floor. Nowadays, most television is recorded. It's one way to make sure that the studios are used to maximum efficiency. The recording itself is made on 2-inch wide magnetic tape on a video recording machine. Later, the tape can be edited electronically and alterations or additions to the sound made in the dubbing theatre. But sometimes it's quite impossible to get the story into the studio, so the studio has to go to the story.
After Downing Street, probably the best known street in Britain, this is a permanent set for Coronation Street, built near the Manchester studios of Granada Television. Here, every week, they will record one or two sequences for Britain's longest-running and best-loved drama series. Sometimes the recording will be made with film cameras, but more often than not, with an outside broadcast unit such as this.
It's a complete mobile studio with its own electronic cameras, its own microphones, its own lights, and its own control room. The director is cutting between cameras and working in exactly the same way that he would in a studio, except there's not so much room. This is only one way in which an OB could be used. There are many others.
And he's right. So there's plenty of top-class action for you there. We've also a seven-race accumulator, an ITV7 from Newcastle and Ayr, another chance for you to show a profit, like the 50 people who won the ITV7 last Saturday managed to do. Here are the top tipster's most fancied selections.
A large part of the world of sport will come from outside broadcast cameras. The local programme company provides the equipment used. Here at Redcar, Yorkshire Television are covering a race meeting, and Yorkshire Television again with London Weekend, Thames and ATV from the Midlands combined to provide the complicated live coverage required for an international golf tournament. Events of all kinds are covered outside the studios, and some of them, Glyndebourne for instance, covered by Southern, are by any standards a major lighting rig. But it's no use producing television pictures if we cannot send the pictures back to the transmitters and into your home. This is a mobile radio link. Using this sort of equipment, television engineers can send the programmes back to the studio live, and of course these days, we're not just restricted to Great Britain. With permanent Eurovision circuits and intercontinental satellites, anything can come or go. We're not broadcasting from these radio links, and you won't be able to pick up the pictures. We are using very short wavelengths, which the parabolic reflector concentrates into a narrow beam, which is pointed back to a similar pickup dish at the studio. So long as the pictures can be produced, engineers will find a way of getting them back from anywhere in the world, so the action can be seen live as it happens.
John Curry, Great Britain.
Well, before the break, a reminder about our adventure film this evening. Adapted from C.S. Forrester's book, The Gun, it's Stanley Kramer's film version, The Pride and the Passion, with a star-studded cast, which includes Cary Grant, Frank Sinatra, and Sophia Loren. And you can join the action at 8.30 tonight.
Fade take one.
Most of the work in a television studio today is concerned with the future, making programmes for transmission at some future date. But there's one part of a studio centre which is very much concerned with the present. This is Southern Television's master control suite in Southampton. From here, Southern passed the programmes out to the IBA transmitters in the Southern area, and many to the network as well.
Fade. Take VCR4. Mix to the clock.
And now we go over to ITN for first report with Peter Snow. The time is 1 o'clock.
Cut.
Programmes may be live from a studio like ITN's First Report, or perhaps from an outside broadcast unit, or it may have been recorded on videotape, or it may be a film which is transmitted through a telecine machine. But however the programme is originated, from here it'll be taken over by the post office engineers. The signals are passed through these U-links to the post office network switching centres, like this one in central London. From there, they're routed to the other ITV studios or to the transmitters themselves.
The white cylinder at the top of this tower contains the aerials of the most powerful television transmitter in the whole of the ITV network. It's here at Crystal Palace and serves 13 million people. Like all the other IBA colour transmitters, it's completely unmanned and unattended. In fact, we believe it to be the most powerful unattended television transmitter in the whole of Europe. We have four transmitters on this site, and this is one of them. Two for vision and two for sound. So only a major breakdown could take us right off the air, when that last happened over 5 years ago. At the heart of each of the four transmitters are these five-cavity klystrons. Down here, the amount of power would barely light an electric torch bulb. Up here, the power is no less than 40 kilowatts of radio frequency. So much waste heat is generated in this type of transmitting valve that we have to use steam to cool them. This is the combining unit room. This is where we put together the output of the vision and the sound transmitters. We do the same thing again up the far end for the other pair, so that when we come to this lot of plumbing here, we have here for the first time the outputs of all four transmitters. That means that right here we have over 100 kilowatts of radio frequency power, enough 5 years ago to char and melt the copper center conductor of this cable, which takes the power to the transmitting aerials. The only breakdown we've ever had since this station was built.
But power isn't everything. One of the big problems for transmitter engineers is to get our signals to a place like this, to fill in the holes behind the hills. Television tends to travel in straight lines. If you can see the receiving point, you can usually transmit to it. In fact, it's often easier to transmit television from the moon to Earth than it is from a transmitter to your home, especially if you live in a mountainous area like this. One way we're hoping to get over the problem of serving small communities is to reduce the size of our rebroadcast transmitters to a suitcase if necessary, so that they become much cheaper. In this way, we hope eventually to be able to afford to install a separate transmitter even for very small communities. This prototype has recently been installed in rural Hampshire. There are over 300 transmitters in the IBA network, and a new one is being built every week. All the sites and masts are shared with the BBC. It's one way to reduce the overall costs of television. These masts vary in size from these small ones to Emly Moor in Yorkshire, which is the tallest concrete structure in Western Europe. All the IBA colour transmitters are unmanned, and some are in very difficult country. For instance, to get television pictures to Western Scotland and the Hebrides, the signals are beamed from a transmitter outside Inverness onto a reflector high on the hills above the Falls of Conon. This deflects them onto the microwave repeater station in the valley below. Access made it quite impossible to build the station itself on the top of the mountain. At this repeater station, the signals are boosted and then passed up to another hilltop where the radio beam is bent to aim it at the second booster station over 20 miles away.
Here at our London Area Control Centre, near Croydon, we're experimenting with the possibility of monitoring, in the future, all our transmitters from just four main transmission control centres. From here, one of our engineers can check the outputs not only of Thames and London Weekend, but those of Southern and Anglia as well. At the same time, our remote control and telemetry equipment is telling us exactly what is going on at each of over 100 unmanned transmitters throughout southeast England. If this field trial is successful, Croydon will be the first of the new regional operational control centres, or ROCs as we call them. By 1980, there will be three more, between them checking and controlling the quality of more than 500 independent television and radio transmitters across the breadth and length of the United Kingdom. And all of it, including the programmes themselves, will be paid for indirectly by advertising revenue. Which reminds me, it's time we had a commercial break. Right now, in each of the 14 independent television regions, separate telecine machines with different commercials are all standing by, ready to roll. Here on the preview monitor is the figure 6 from the film leader in one of them. It will take 5 seconds to run up to speed and will fade to black at 3. Join us in part 2 when we shall be talking about how television is changing. Standby network, roll telecine.
We recently road tested the current model of pedestrian. Morning cold start, poor. Fuel consumption, heavy. The model needed topping up throughout the day. Road holding, fair. But in bad conditions, brakes were unreliable. And although the same model has been in production for some time now, spare parts are hard to obtain. However, the makers assure us that it is rust-proof and all essential parts should last a lifetime. But where our model really did badly was resistance to damage. All tests show that in collision with other vehicles, it always came off worst, with 27,000 each year seriously damaged or total write-offs. So we strongly recommend that when you take this model on the roads, you proceed at all times with great caution.
Triumph for the engineers who designed and built it, and for the airlines that fly it. A fundamental step forward in technology and in travel. Some people like it more than others, but everyone agrees that it's a milestone, a turning point, and air travel will never be quite the same again, and it will be news for some time yet. So what better way to look at some of the changing techniques in television than to use Concorde to take us to look at one television idea, which again is a fundamental step forward. Again, some people will like it more than others, but everyone agrees that it's a milestone, a turning point. Television will never be quite the same again, and it too is about speed, and it too is news, and it's in Chicago. This is the main newsroom of CBS station WBBM in Chicago. This is one of the first of the major newsrooms of the world to start the major changeover from film to all electronic methods of news gathering. Like Concorde, they're very new, they're very highly sophisticated and very fast. Soon, there won't even be a foot of film in this building. No film cameras, not even the means of processing film. The electronic minicam units, which are replacing film, are contained in specially built vans like these. Each vehicle costs around £60,000 in US dollars. For news coverage, it is operated by two men. They are driver, cameraman, sound man, video recordist, communication and links man, all rolled into two. The city of Chicago, with its 3 million inhabitants, is a good news gathering area. Each unit covers 6 or 7 assignments a day. 2 or 3 of them could be injected into the news bulletins live. The flashing lights scan the various radio channels used by the police and the emergency services. When the light stops flashing, the assignments girl can listen in and see just where and what the emergency is. And the radio-controlled minicam units can keep in touch with the news desk wherever they are in the area. Eden's Expressway, the main highway between Milwaukee and Chicago. Some say the busiest stretch of motorway in the whole of the United States. It's 6 minutes to 6, and as you can see, the traffic is building up at the end of a swelteringly hot bank holiday weekend. The newsroom, like newsrooms all over the world, want to show the traffic building up, but they want to do it live, behind the headlines, in 6 minutes' time. Above us on the bridge is the minicam camera that is going to photograph the traffic. And away to the left, through 500 feet of umbilical cord, you see the truck standing by with the microwave dish on top, ready to beam these pictures as they happen, direct into CBS 6 o'clock news. Over the two-way radio, the technician back at base can direct the positioning of the microwave dish. If for any reason the signal cannot be got back live, then the material is recorded, either inside or outside the van, on this portable recorder. The radio telephone is an essential tool of the operation. The signals from the dish can be bounced off the skyscrapers of Chicago and still picked up in a satisfactory broadcast form. Electronic cameras usually have to be lined up or adjusted before they're ready to broadcast, but these minicams are just plugged in and in a matter of seconds they're ready to shoot.
And here's how the signal gets back to the newsroom. Right behind me is the John Hancock building, towering 1,456 feet above the city of Chicago. And if you look at the base of the twin transmitting towers on the roof of that building, you'll see a whole collection of microwave trough aerials, one in each direction. Now, from anywhere in the city, you can pick up on the top of that building and it goes right back from there to the CBS newsroom.
The speed-up in news gathering has not only been brought about by improved communications and fast and flexible minicam units. With this new machine, pictures on videotape, which, unlike film, you cannot see through with the naked eye, can be frozen, inched backwards and forwards, and the actual editing point chosen and memorized. On the push of a button, the machine puts the edited tape together.
Get that frame out of there. There we go. That's a nice picture. Yes, it is. It's a good picture.
And so the daily News on 2 in Chicago goes on the air.
This is Channel 2 News with Bill Curtis, Walter Jacobson, and the Channel 2 News team. John Coughlin with the weather and Johnny Morris on sports.
Of course, the thing that's made all this development in electronic news gathering possible is the progressive reduction in the size of television camera tubes. This big boy here, the 4.5-inch image orthicon, was the workhorse of the black and white television era. But fortunately, before we came to go into color, new camera tubes have been developed, such as this plumbicon. Color cameras such as this, which are used in the studios, have 3 plumbicons, one for each of the 3 primary colors, red, green and blue. Similarly, smaller plumbicon tubes have been used in these cameras that we've been showing for electronic news gathering earlier in the programme, red, green and blue once again. But the further cameras are under development, also using this camera tube. This is going to be the next generation of the minicam. But that's not the end of the story, because instead of using camera tubes, there are new devices being made now, which in 2 or 3 years' time will replace the television camera tube. This is known as the CCD, or charge-coupled device. This is not yet ready for broadcast use, but when it is, there's a camera already for it. This is the new micro cam that will take the CCD, small. This will transform television reporting in the next 2 to 5 years.
As you'd expect, all the pictures in that report from America, including the studio scenes, were shot with minicams. But there's one big drawback to electronic news gathering as far as international exchange of programmes is concerned. Different countries use different scanning rates, which are just not compatible with each other. We believe this to be the world's fastest special-purpose computer. It converts pictures. It was developed by IBA engineers and first used operationally by ITN in London. It's called DICE, short for Digital Intercontinental Conversion Equipment. And as its name suggests, it uses computer techniques to store and to manipulate digital picture information. Let's put Chicago on the line again. This is what the pictures would have looked like without the help of DICE. And this is what DICE achieves. Let's look at it more closely. If we take one of the 625 lines which make up this television picture, say of Crawley Court again, you'll remember that this is what the voltage waveform looks like on any chosen line, and that the variations in it depend on the changing degree of brightness along the line. This is known as an analog signal, because it varies smoothly and continuously in proportion to the variations of brightness. And it's this waveform that we superimpose on a radio wave carrier and try to transmit without distortion. A digital waveform is different. It consists of a train of pulses, all the same height, which are relatively immune to distortion, but from which the original analog waveform can be reconstructed. To reduce the rate at which we have to send pulses, we only measure the brightness at a limited number of points along the line, and at each point, we approximate the brightness to a number of fixed level. Look at this young lady, both of her, and I'll show you what I mean. The picture on the left is normal. Stephanie, please hold it a moment. Now, if you look at the corresponding waveform, you'll see how very different the picture on the right really is. Instead of all the variations of brightness being reproduced, we've restricted ourselves to 8 brightness levels only. The waveform's been quantized, as we call it, into 8 levels. Your eye will see the difference between these two pictures. But if instead of 8 levels, we break the pictures down to 256 levels, it won't notice any difference at all. Let's go down through the levels again. Stephanie, please dance. 128, 64, 32, 16. Now, you'll begin to see the contouring. 8, 4, now the waveform's coming in distinct numbers, and finally 2. And back up again. Now, each of these 256 levels of brightness is assigned an individual number using a computer type binary code. The numbers are transmitted as a stream of digits, rather like extraordinarily high-speed Morse. By using a computer code, not only is the system made very rugged, but extremely complex signal processing becomes practicable also. Because the television scanning process stops for no one, DICE has to perform its calculations very, very fast indeed. A ray of light travelling at 186,000 miles a second, can encircle the globe in only 1/7 of a second. But DICE has to add together two 8-digit binary numbers in the time that a ray of light has travelled only 19 inches. It's as fast as that. Let's see DICE in action. On the left, the dancer is being seen through a 625-line colour camera operating on the British PAL colour system at 25 pictures per second. On the right, she's being seen through a 525-line colour camera operating on the American NTSC colour system of 30 pictures per second. But that picture is being converted live by DICE here to our British television system so we can superimpose the two pictures together. It's all being done by binary arithmetic, computer style, very fast, by the equivalent of 16 million transistors. Now, if one connects the output of DICE's digital picture store back to its input, the same information goes round and around, and one gets a still picture, of course. DICE continually checks and corrects itself. It's now recycling the still picture without any input, in and out of its number store, without any deterioration. We've run this for hours and hours, waiting for the picture to deteriorate, but it hasn't, even though the picture has been recycled billions of times. You couldn't have done that with the old-fashioned analog system. DICE is a good example of how computers are changing television. Another is in the permanent holiday world of the Channel Islands. If you were fortunate enough to live there, you might have had sunshine, sea air, sandcastles, but until recently, you wouldn't have had colour television.
What we would like to do here in Alderney is to pick up our Stockland Hills transmitting station near Honiton in Devon, that's 70 miles away and over the horizon, and microwave the signal on to our main transmitting station at Fremont Point in Jersey. The only trouble is that there's so many other transmitting stations in Britain, Ireland, Holland and France, all transmitting on the same channel, that we predict for some of the time the interference could be as bad as this. This chart shows the problem. What we really need is an aerial that will accept only the Stockland Hill transmissions and which actually rejects all of the others. But there's no way this can be done using conventional aerial techniques that we know of. So we have under development a very special experimental aerial. This actually is a computer-controlled adaptive aerial system. We believe it's the first of its type in the world. This is one of the 16 panels, or dipoles we call them, that make up the experimental aerial. And when the aerial is complete, there'll be four complete units, so 64 of these altogether. Now, aerials like these can have very definite polar diagrams, as we call them. That is the pattern that shows the direction in which the aerial is sensitive and the direction in which it's insensitive. Now, one of the problems of long over the horizon, over the sea paths like this is that one moment the interference coming in from over there can perhaps be stronger, and a few minutes later, the one from that direction is stronger. So what we need to do is somehow or other electrically adjust the polar diagram of the aerial so that it maximizes the reception from Stockland Hill and keeps the nulls the whole time pointed on the unwanted sources of interference. To do this, we use a microprocessor, continuously sampling every one of the dipoles all the time and adjusting the amplitude and the phase of the currents so that we can steer the polar diagram so that the nulls are in the direction of the unwanted signals. This is the polar diagram. Circled to the left of centre, you see the direction of the wanted signal from Stockland Hill in Devon. The other arrows show the direction of the unwanted signals. As the computer takes charge, watch how it first makes adjustments to swing the main beam towards the wanted signal, and then progressively adjusts the amplitude and phase contributions of each of the dipoles so as to steer the nulls in the direction of the unwanted signals. Now let's see the dramatic improvement to the picture itself as the computer takes charge. On the lower trace, you will see the voltage outputs from the computer adjusting the contributions made by each of the dipoles and thus changing its polar diagram to put the interference into the nulls. Once the picture has been cleaned up and received at Alderney, it is sent by microwave link here to Fremont Point, the main UHF transmitter of the Channel Islands group, and from Fremont Point on to the relay station serving Guernsey.
Yet another new application of computer techniques to television is the experimental teletext service. The ITV version is known as Oracle, the BBC version is called CFAX. But both are now technically compatible, and an experimental teletext receiver can receive both. What is teletext? We're using two spare lines to carry some digital pulses on our television transmissions to give you an up-to-the-minute information service. If I reduce the height of this picture, but please don't do this at home, you'll see some spare lines at the top of the picture which form the margin. The twinkling dots are the pulses carrying the Oracle service. Additional circuits in a teletext receiver will convey the pulses and convert them into this type of printed page. Up to 800 of them. 802 produces the news headlines, 803 the stock exchange prices, and all sorts of other information.
Right, okay, thank you very much.
Traffic delay there.
The information is prepared and assembled by teams of journalists at London Weekend Television and ITN, typed up and fed into the system through a computer-type video display unit for anyone to look at, provided they have a receiver with the extra teletext circuits incorporated. It may, I stress may, be possible to transmit Oracle by radio. Now, think about it a second. If you adjust your television set so that it's not tuned to any channel, you won't have a picture on it. But it's still switched on, the tube is still scanning, 625 lines, 25 times a second. It's just that you're not feeding any picture information to it. Now, the Oracle picture information originates from inside your set here. The information which activates this, of course, is, as I told you, superimposed on the first few lines of the television picture. But it doesn't have to be. It could be superimposed on an ordinary FM radio signal. Just think of the possibilities that this would open up. Here's a special experimental radio which also detects Oracle type information. The data output from this special radio receiver is plugged into the teletext receiver, which is on but tuned to a blank television channel. Now, let's tune the radio. And we have the ninth symphony. And lo and behold, on the television screen comes Beethoven's ninth symphony, the choral. Let's tune to another radio station.
Just in time to see the mouse put up a notice which said, "No callers today, please," and firmly close the front door. Thomas scratched himself.
And now we have a children's story, and the name comes up on the screen. Remember, Radio Oracle is only a possibility at this stage. It's still under investigation in our laboratories, as are many other new technologies.
Of course, data may be conveyed to your television set in many other ways. There's no technical reason why one shouldn't feed in data via the ordinary telephone network, for example. And this idea is what the post office call view data. You see, by adding a teletext capability to your domestic television set and then coupling it up to the ordinary telephone as in view data, we have, in effect, turned your domestic television into a domestic computer terminal, and all sorts of exciting possibilities suddenly become practicable.
Now, I happen to bank at the National Westminster Bank in Winchester High Street. And like many other banks, they keep their accounts on a computer. But I can dial into mine by telephone. So let's see how my account is standing. Here I have a perfectly standard, modern post office push-button telephone. Dial code from Winchester, 0962. And the bank's number is 622-597. That's the sound you get when you get a computer online. And here on my modern view data display, you can see it. Bank statement service, it says, what is your account number, please? Well, my account number is 0655-0983. Computer's thinking about this. And it says, what is your security check number, please? Now, your security check number is exactly the same number as you have if you have a cash dispenser card. It's something that's private to you, and you can get the bank to change it any time you think somebody else knows what it is. And as you might expect, we've had a special number arranged for this program. And the number that I've been given is 53734. 53734. Now, if I got this wrong, the computer would bar all further access, and that would be the end of it. But it hasn't. It says, your inquiry is accepted. Please wait while your file is accessed. And here it comes. Everything I need to... Oh, my goodness. The flashing red on the final total is unavoidable if your bank is, statement is overdrawn at this time. I think we'd better put the telephone down on that. It's not good news. What about another example? Let's supposing that I'm kept late at the office and I miss my train home. I try to find my wife, but she's out and I can't get any reply. I can't try again later or I really will miss the train. So what do I use? I use the new experimental electronic message service. To get hold of that, all you have to do is to dial 200. Again, we have the sound of a computer online, and here we have it. The electronic message service, and it says, please select your message from the following categories. 1, birthdays and anniversaries. 2, commuter's message service. 3, requests to telephone. And 4, illnesses and disasters. Well, clearly I need message number 2, the commuter's message service. And here it is, commuter's message service. In some of the messages that follow, it says there's space for the appropriate time, the space marked as 4 asterisks, use a 24-hour clock and so on. First, dial the message you require. 1, I'll be on the train that arrives at da-da-da. 2, please meet at the station at da-da-da. 3, please telephone me at the office. And 4, don't wait up for me tonight. It's a pretty brave person that uses that message very frequently, I can tell you. Well, I need, obviously, message number 1. And it will come up. It says, oh, please enter the time required using the 24-hour clock. Use 4 digits. What's we say? 7:45. That's 1945. And it says, message reads, I'll be on the train that arrives at 1945. Dial 1 to send it or 0 to edit it. It's okay, so dial 1. And it says, now, please dial the telephone number of the subscriber to whom the message is to be sent, followed by 0010. Well, it's very important to get this right, of course, because you don't want to send a message like this to the other fellow's wife. So here we go, 0962-822-414. And then 0010, and 1 for luck. And it says, message sent. When my wife gets home, she finds the message waiting light alight on her telephone. She switches the television set to teletext. She dials the electronic message service. And there on the screen is the message that I sent, and underneath it, the details of where it came from. Now, before we go any further, I must make it perfectly clear that those two demonstrations were both simulations. I wasn't using the public telephone for either demonstration. A bank account cannot yet be interrogated by telephone, and in any case, mine is never overdrawn, at least never by such a trivial amount.
Similarly, the commuter's message service is but a twinkle in the designer's eye until the post office have completed their evaluation of view data. But both services are technically feasible now, and we're already using the technology to display the status of all the unmanned transmitters in our colour network. But that is a whole new subject, and we really haven't time to deal with that now. So, on behalf of Boris Townsend and myself, I wish you goodbye. Stephanie, could we please have the end credits?
Copies of this program are available for use by schools, colleges, and private organizations. For further information, contact the Press Office, HTV, Bath Road, Bristol, Avon.
This holiday Tuesday on ITV, sit back and be entertained by the most enchanting creatures in the world and experience the lure of the dolphins.
Exactly how you classify telepathy, but they know what I'm going to do before I'm doing it.
Chanting Lure of the Dolphins at 2 o'clock this holiday Tuesday on ITV.
Following today's news at 1:05, we present the charming cartoon Ukalik. This Canadian folktale tells the story of an Eskimo boy who makes friends with the hare he rescues from the Arctic waste. Native Eskimo songs accompany the narration of Ukalik, a cartoon for all the family, following the news at 1:05. You're watching Granada, and now a journey to the far side of the moon in this morning's film.